But Thakur started or maintained the temple that his father had built at the appearance site or birth site of Lord Chaitanya in Mayapur. So that they're divided by the Ganges River, those two places. As time went on, one young Brahmin boy from Calcutta came to Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur and said, "I want you to be my guru." And he said, "Okay." So he was serving him in Mayapur, but at that time Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was managing the yoga pit, the place where Lord Chaitanya appeared. And, you know, whenever you're managing temple, you have to deal with different personalities, you have to deal with budgets and money. And this Brahmin boy came to the conclusion that Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur wasn't as advanced as he thought he was, because he was always managing the temple and so forth. So he left him and went across the Ganges to Navadvip and begged Gaurakishore Babaji if he could serve him. And at that time, Gaurakishore Babaji was living in the a type of outhouse, latrine, a public latrine. And he did that on purpose so people wouldn't bother him. They would think he's crazy or something. It wouldn't bother him. And so this person, this young Brahmin boy, started serving him. And as time went on, because he was always with him, he became like a close assistant, primary assistant. And he didn't like Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. So every time Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur would come to see Gaurakishore Babaji, he wouldn't let him in. He says, "He's busy, can't see you." And Bhaktisiddhanta understood what was happening, but he couldn't really do anything about it. So Gaurakishore Babaji had told this Brahmin boy, he's told him that he should never accept any of the offerings of opulent prasadam that people would bring him. And he should never do anything to break the standard that Gaurakishore Babaji had of strict austerity. But because this boy became more and more prominent, every time people would bring opulent prasadam, he would secretly keep it and eat it. And because of that, eventually he started philandering with women, taking advantage of them because of his position. And Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, after being rejected about 5 or 10 times from seeing Gaurakishore Babaji, he became very concerned. And one day he spoke a little loudly outside the latrine, and Gaurakishore Babaji heard him, and he came out and said, "Bhaktisiddhanta, why is your father in the land of Maya?" He was implying that, you know, Bhaktivinod was staying in Calcutta, you know, at that time. And he said he should leave Maya. And then he sent something else also to that seemed very strange to Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. So then he realized that his guru was giving him some instruction. Of course, his father was not in Maya. His father's a pure devotee, right? But anyway, he understood that he gave him some instruction. So at one point, he met Gaurakishore Babaji privately, and he told him about his disciple, you know. So Gaurakishore Babaji knew about it, but he had not done anything yet. You know, he was hoping the boy would change. So then he finally told the boy, he said, "Look, you go back home to your parents, you serve them nicely, and you get married, and you live an honest life, and stop this pretense of being some big yogi, a big renunciate, and making a sham of and a laughing stock of this whole thing." And so the boy was, let's say, sober enough to listen to him, and he did exactly what he told him to do. And then from that point on, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was able to serve his guru again more intimately. So you see, life is not some idealistic thing. Even Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur had to go through a lot of difficulties due to inappropriate or, let's say, substandard disciples of Gaur Kishore Babaji that were hindering. They actually stopped him from seeing his guru for a long time. It went on for years, and he just tolerated it until it was intolerable. So the material world is full of these types of situations, and one must learn to tolerate them. Otherwise, we become extremely discouraged and it's easy to lose faith in Krishna consciousness when you're faced with situations that are contrary to what is a normal standard for Krishna conscious behavior. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur has written this beautiful bhajan. It's called Vaishnava K, Who is a Real Vaishnava? And it has a lot of deep meaning in it, especially if you look in verse number 8, he says, Tomara pratista sukarer vista tar sahasama kabu na manava matsarata vase tumi jadarase majesho chadiya kirtana sostava. And he says, verse number 8, your cheap reputation is equal to the stool of a hog. An ordinary ambitious man like you can never be equated with a devotee of Madhavendra Puri's eminence. Under the sway of envy, you have drowned yourself in the filthy waters of material enjoyment after having abandoned the excellent perfection of congregational kirtan. So that is a very significant verse. It has a lot of deep meaning in it. We'll sing this bhajan now and then come back and talk about that wonderful verse. Tusta mana tumi kishera vaishnav pratishtatare nirjanagare. Tusta mana tumi kishera vaishnav pratishtatare nirjanagare. Patistar tare nirjanir gare tavahari nama keval kaita. Patistar tare nirjanir gare tavahari nama keval kaita. Dum chik chik dum da da dum da da dum. Chade patista sukera vistara janana kita haramayar vaiva kanaka kamini divasa yamini bhaviya kika jananitya sesa. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Tomara kanaka bogera janaka kanake dware seva humada Kamenirkama Nahitahabadama Tahar Malika Kevalayada. Now we sing together. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Tomara Kanaka, Pogera Janaka, Kanakira Dware Sevo Mada. Kaminir Kama Nahitava Dama Tar Malika Kevalayada. Everyone. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Patista Hasa Tarunadanaya Guru. Patista Hasataru Jadamaya Maru Napela Ravana Gujiya Raga. Vaishnavi Pratista Tahate Korujista Tahana Bajile Nari Bemora. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Hari jana dvesa pratistha sa klesa korokeno tabirtha gura. Vaishnavir pache pratistha sa ache tate kabu nahi anitya vaibha. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Se Hari Sambandha Sunya Maya Ganda Taha Kabu Noi Jadikaita. Pratista Chandali Nirjanata Jali Ubaye Jani Omaya Kavrora. Hare Kirtana chabibo pratistha makibo ki kaja dudiyam tarasa gora. Madhavendra puri baba gahare churi nakori loka bhikada janibo. Hare Krishna, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Tomara Pratista, Sukha Hare Vista, Tarasaha Sama Kabuna Mana. Matsaratta vase tumi jada rase majesho chadiya kirtana sostava. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Tai Tustamana Nirjana Bhajana Pacharicho Chalichu Yogi Vaiba Prabhu Sanatane Paramahajatane Siksa Dilo Yaha Chinto Sesa Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama. Se dutikata bulo sansa bulo nasarvata uchaswari kuru nari namarava Fagua yukta badara Fagua yukta badara mukta Kabunaba vios ehikar sabha Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur addresses his mind and he says, O wicked mind, what kind of Vaishnava do you think you are? Your pretentious show of chanting Lord Hari's holy name in a solitary place is only for the sake of obtaining the false prestige of a worldly reputation. It is nothing but pure hypocrisy. So if you look at this beautiful poem that Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati has written, you'll see that almost every verse he mentions the word pratistha. Now, what is pratistha? Pratistha means false claim being important. It means vastly overinflated valuation of oneself. It's false pride. And obviously, this is a very dangerous thing for a Vaishnava. Therefore, almost in every verse, he mentions this word pratistha, because it can ruin a person's spiritual life by being attached to name and fame and position and always being like the center of attraction and having this false prestige. And if someone tries to imitate Haridas Thakur without the qualities of Haridas Thakur, that is exactly pratistha. Chanting, let's say, unendingly in a solitary place, doing some kind of severe austerity like that. And he says, your pretentious show of chanting Lord Hari's holy name in a solitary place is only for the sake of attaining the false prestige of a worldly reputation. It is nothing but pure hypocrisy. And I have seen a certain number of devotees who have left the West and gone to Radha Kund. And ostensibly they chant Hare Krishna all day long in Radha Kunj. But many of them, unfortunately, I've seen and heard of, they gradually degenerate into smoking marijuana and chanting Hare Krishna, you know, or doing even worse things. So Prabhupada emphasized doing practical, time-sensitive devotional service. And he recommended 16 good rounds a day. It doesn't take more than about an hour and a half if you're concentrating to chant 16 good rounds a day. And the rest of the day should be engaged in other Krishna conscious activity, like taking part in a class and doing all kinds of services in the temple, cooking, cleaning, preaching, deity worship, and all the backup activity for deity worship, and so forth, in Sankirtan, being engaged 24 hours a day in Krishna service. Now, a lot of people work, that's just fine. If you're regulated in work, then you'll be regulated in your devotional service also. And at least once a day, grihasthas should come to the temple, have darshan, see the deity, bow down to the deity, take part in the kirtan, hear class, take prasadam. At least once a day, whether it's early in the morning for Mangalarti or it's at night. And preferably twice a day is even better, if you can attend the morning program and the evening program. That way your life is fully Krishna conscious. But this trying to gain name and fame by doing some type of artificial austerity that is not tenable anyway. Like I've seen people, they say, well, no, I'm gonna do Nirjal Ekadasi, you know, every Monday. You know. So Prabhupada didn't ask us to do Nirjal Ekadasi every Monday. He asked us to fast on Ekadasi twice a month. And once a year, it's recommended to do Bhima Nirjal Ekadasi. So by adding on, in a speculative way, extra austerities, and thus diminishing your practical devotional service based on hearing and chanting, it doesn't make sense. It's better to have a balanced schedule of hearing and chanting and serving, and performing those extra austerities on the recommended days. If you count the recommended days with Ekadasi and Janmashtami and Ram Nomi, all those days, it's over 1 month of fasting. It's like Ramadan. Except Ramadan they do, you know, 30 days. We do it like a special month. We do it gradually throughout the whole year. Because the whole idea is to maintain regulated devotional service. The morning and evening programs and working honestly. So the second verse, he says, such materialistic prestige. Again, he's using the word pratista in the second verse. He uses it in the first verse, the second verse, and then fourth verse, fifth verse, sixth verse, seventh verse, eighth verse. And so 8 out of the 10 verses, he's talking about pratista, this false, acquiring false prestige. Working for name and fame rather than working sincerely and humbly for serving Krishna. He says, such materialistic prestige is as disgusting as the stool of a hog. So he refers to pratista twice in this poem, to sukhera vista, on in verse 2nd and verse 8. He says, jader pratista sukhera vista. And then verse 8 he says, tomara pratista sukhera vista. Tomara in Bengali means your false claim to fame, name and fame is like the stool of a pig. Now, I asked Bhakti Chiru Maharaj about this, and he said, you see, he said, the pig already eats stool. So just imagine how bad his stool is, how bad the pig stool is. That's why he's using such a repugnant phrase here. describe pratishtha when it becomes like a goal of a Vaishnava to have name and fame, you know, always have their name forward and taking credit for this, taking credit for that, you know. So it's compared to, and you can remember this phrase, sukera vishta, the stool of a pig. Right? There's nothing worse than that. Let's put it like that. So he says, such materialistic prestige is disgusting as the stool of a hog. Do you not know that it is only a mere illusion cast by the potency of Maya? What is the value of contemplating day and night your plans for enjoying wealth and women? All these things are only temporary. When you claim wealth as your own, it creates in you ever-increasing desires for material enjoyment. Your riches should be used for serving Madhava, the Lord of all wealth. Neither is it your proper place to indulge in lust for women, whose only true proprietor is Lord Yadava. In other words, everything belongs to Krishna, whether it's wealth or whether it's persons that can be enjoyed. Everything should be for the pleasure of Krishna. So that's the difference between material life and spiritual life. In material life, people have the misconception that that enjoying material pleasures is the goal of life. So, misconceptions are the enemy of the living entity. And there are many misconceptions taught in public schools today and universities and glorified in glossy magazines and Bollywood movies and Hollywood movies and in the news and things like that. So, one of those false conceptions is that the purpose of life is to enjoy life. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we shall die. This was a famous thing that the gladiators used to say in the Colosseum in Rome. Every night they would eat, drink, and be merry, because the next day they would go out and try and kill each other as entertainment for the public. See, in those days they didn't have movies, so they had real movies. They had, you know, what do you call it? Reality TV. They had the Colosseum. You can see the Colosseum today. If you visit Rome, it's still there. The Romans built that building so good that it's still standing right in the center of Rome. It was built over 2,000 years ago. And what was the Colosseum? It was a place, it was for public entertainment. They didn't have movies. They had reality. So the gladiators were trained men. They were strong, powerful men. And they would fight to the death. Somebody had to die every day. And it was horrible. But this was the people's entertainment. Well, what's people's entertainment today? Huh? What do you see on TV? The most popular films are war, crime, right? In every let's say, entertainment film, there's usually some murder. Suspense. Yeah, violence. So they had the same thing 2,000 years ago in Rome, but it was for real. And then they also would put prisoners, and they would have to fight to the death. And then they would persecute Christians. They would put Christians into the Colosseum, and then they would let loose wild, hungry lions and tigers and bears, and they would go in and tear the people apart and eat them. And this was their entertainment of the people. You know, so when you claim wealth as your own, it creates in you ever-increasing desires for material enjoyment. Your riches should be used for serving Madhava, the Lord of all wealth. Neither is it your proper place to indulge in lust for women, whose only true proprietor is Lord Yadava. So this concept of proprietorship is the basis of the organization of society. So you'll see that societies are organized based on a concept of proprietorship. Like, for example, we live in a capitalist society today. In capitalist society, the principle of proprietorship is individual proprietorship. So most of the laws in this country protect individual proprietorship. Now, if you can, you can switch countries. You go to a place like Sweden, or you could have gone to communist Russia. The concept of proprietorship there is socialism. Socialism says that the government is the proprietor, and individuals have very limited proprietorship. So therefore, the government runs the banks, the government runs the industries, and so forth. So therefore, most of the laws protect government proprietorship. Now, if you go to a real communist country, like Mao Zedong in China and things like that, they believe that there's no individual proprietorship, that everything should belong to the people. But because they can't trust the people right away, the government takes over everything until that day where they can turn it over to the people. That never happened in communist Russia, and it didn't really happen in China either. But anyway, that theory is that the people own everything, not there's no individual ownership. And then in a monarchy, the theory of proprietorship is the king and the nobles own everything, and the people don't own anything. And then in a dictatorship, the concept is that the dictator and the military industrial people who cooperate with him are the owners. Again, the people don't really own anything. Right? And then in chaos or anarchic society, nobody owns anything. See? Now, each one of those concepts of proprietorship, which are at the base of the social and political organization of countries, are false. That's why nobody's really happy. Just there's some temporary happiness and then there's mostly misery. Why? Because the real concept of proprietorship is that everything belongs to Krishna. Vihaya kamam yasarvam pumam charati nispraha nirmama nirahankara sasanti madigachati. You know, nirmama nirahankara. Nothing belongs to us. Everything belongs to Krishna. So that's the principle in the temple here. Everything belongs to Krishna. Therefore, whatever donations we give, Jai Shri Shri Radha Nila Madhava Ki Jai Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Vistaya Bhuti Samati Bhati Swati Namaste Sarasati Devi Guru Acharya Vistaya Saraskati Asatani. Whatever donations we give, it's given to the deity, and then it's used in the service of Krishna, and we make different offerings to Krishna, and then Krishna offers it back as his prasadam, and then we distribute the prasadam for everyone's benefit. That's called spiritual communism. It's not that everything belongs to the people, or belongs to the individual, or belongs to the government, or belongs to the king, or belongs to the dictator. Everything belongs to Krishna. And when we offer things to Krishna, then Krishna offers it back as his prasadam, and then the prasadam is equally distributed to everyone. So, as long as there's a misconception about proprietorship, whatever social and political organization is put in place, it will not make the people happy. Then he says, the demon Ravana, who was lust incarnate, fought with Lord Ramachandra, who was love incarnate, in order to gain the tree of worldly reputation. So again, that's pratista sataru. And then he says, but that oasis turned out to be but a mirage cast in the desert wasteland of the Lord's illusory material potency. Please cultivate fixed determination to attain only the steady and solid platform whereupon a Vaishnava ever stands. If you neglect worshiping the Lord from this position, then you will ultimately attain a hellish existence. So one must be steady with a sankalpa, determination to remain on the path of Sanatana Dharma, of Krishna consciousness, and not in any way compromise or leave the normal daily practices of Krishna consciousness, which is chanting minimum 16 good rounds a day, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, accepting only prasadam, nothing that hasn't been offered to Krishna, and regularly hearing Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, and coming to the temple and doing service. These are four absolute requirements, and then further four requirements: avoiding meat eating, fish, eggs, chicken, etc., avoiding gambling, avoiding philandering, and avoiding intoxication, including coffee and tea. So if you follow these four things to do and four things not to do, you lead a life that is on the level of sattva guna, goodness. It's only when one comes to goodness that one can actually learn spiritual knowledge and assimilate it. So, Ravana was lust incarnate, and Rama was love incarnate. So there's a difference between lust and love, just like there's a difference between iron and gold. Lust is not love. And everyone is seeking love, but they usually think that lust is love. There's this lady, I think her name is Joan Collins. They call her Lady Joan. She's an English woman who became a famous actress in the United States. Now she's about 88 years old. But she dresses like she's 16. You know. You can't really tell how old she is because she has very long hair, and her hair is very well done, you know, by professional hairdressers. Every time she goes out, this long flowing hair looks like a teenage girl. But when you actually see her face, you realize she's a very old woman, right? But, you know, she's done everything to seem as if she's young. So she was in an interview, and she's been married about four or five times and divorced. And now she's with her husband, she's been married to for a longer time, maybe more than 20 years. And they asked her, well, you know, how is your life with your husband? She said, oh, it's full of lust. Now, see, that was supposed to be a good statement, right? It's an 86-year-old woman saying, our life is full of lust, you know. But that is different than love. Lust is an exploitation of one person of another. Right. And love is dedication. There's a difference between exploitation and dedication. In love, a person is willing to sacrifice due to love to help another person. Lust, if one's lust is not satisfied, they become angry and vicious. Right. So we don't have to talk any more about that. There are a lot of examples of that in the news where lust is not satisfied. Sometimes people kill their partner because of that. So there's a major difference between lust and love. So Ravana is described as lust incarnate, and Ramachandra is described as love incarnate. But Ravana, due to his lust, he wanted to gain worldly reputation. He tried to convince Sita that he was invincible. That even he defeated the demigods. He defeated Kubera. He defeated Indra. And she said, he told her, your husband, it's impossible for him to come to Lanka. Even the devas can't come here. And your husband has no kingdom. He has no army. He has no treasury. He's just walking around in the forests of India. Sita, Sita, where are you? With tears in his eyes. So he characterized Rama as an ineffectual and defeated person. And he built up himself as, you know, the owner of the Pushpaka airplane that can go anywhere in the universe. And he lives in a city of gold and jewels. And at his command is an army of minimum 33 million rakshasas and so forth. So he was painting a picture of his worldly reputation that is considered Sukera Vishta, the stool of a pig. You see, and so this is the characteristic of demoniac tendency people. They're very attached to pratistha, name and fame, building up their worldly prestige. And then he says, why do you needlessly suffer the torment of blaspheming the devotees of Lord Hari, attempting to achieve their eminence, thereby only proving your own fruitless foolishness? The desire for spiritual eminence is easily fulfilled when one becomes a devotee of the Lord, for eternal fame automatically follows the heels of a Vaishnava, and that fame is never to be considered a temporary worldly opulence. So another symptom of people who are attached to pratistha, worldly fame, is that they will blaspheme genuine Vaishnavas to try and belittle them and to make themselves look important. And it says here, why do you needlessly suffer the torment of blaspheming the devotees of Lord Hari, attempting to achieve their eminence? In other words, by belittling the genuine devotees, they try and enhance their position as a pseudo big devotee, and thereby only proving your own fruitless foolishness. It's a foolish endeavor if someone insults. In fact, it's one of the offenses against the holy name to blaspheme devotees who have dedicated their lives to propagating the holy name. So it's the first offense against the holy name. This is the quality of people like Ravana, who are lust incarnate. And he says, the desire for spiritual eminence is easily fulfilled when one becomes a devotee of the Lord. Therefore, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Lord Chaitanya says that one should be more humble than the straw in the street. Trinadapi sunichena, tarurapi sahistana, amanina manadena, kirtaniya sadahari. And more tolerant than the tree, and ready to respect all others, even though they don't respect you. And so these are symptoms of genuine Vaishnava. And then Nadanam, Najanam, Nasundarim, Kavitam Va, Jagadishi Kamaye, Mama Janmani, Janmani Swaray, Bhavatad Bhakti Rahai Tuki Twai. Genuine Vaishnava is not interested in Dhanam, money, accumulating wealth. And Janam, he's not interested in having a lot of disciples or a big family, having, you know, 10 sons or whatever. And Nasundaram, he's not interested in exploiting the opposite sex. He's not interested in making victims of people for his own sense gratification. And Mama Janmani Janmaniswari, he's not interested in liberation, in mukti. He simply wants to serve Krishna life after life. He's not asking for anything. Whereas Ravana-like people are always asking for a position, for recognition, for fame, etc. The relationship between a devotee and Lord Hari is devoid of even a trace of worldly illusion. It has nothing to do with the materialistic cheating propensity. The prestige of so-called popularity in the material realm is compared to a treacherous dog-eating witch, and the attempt to live in solitude to supposedly engage in unalloyed bhajans is compared to an entangling network of distraction. Please know that anyone striving in either of these ways verily lives in the hell of Maya's illusion. Now, this is a very powerful words by Bhakti Srinath Saraswati Thakur. And only a person who's had a lot of experience in Krishna consciousness would understand the depth of what he's talking about. He says, the prestige of so-called popularity in the material realm is compared to a treacherous dog-eating witch. So the words there is Pratista Chandali Nir Janata Jali Ubaye Janiyo Maika Rorava. Now Rorava is a wild dog. They have these type of wild dogs in hell. They're called Ruhus. And As soon as you arrive in hell, I hope you never go to hell. As soon as you arrive there, they start biting you. Like, for example, this was in the news yesterday. There was a Rottweiler, I think that's the name, this special type of dog. A man went to a dog hostel where, you know, they collect wild dogs that have been abandoned, and they take care of them, and then they adopt them. They give them up for adoption, and people come and take the dog. So this man, he was like 63 years old, big, you know, healthy guy. He went to the dog hostel, and he took a dog out. They gave him a dog. And these type of dogs, I think their name is Rottweiler. These type of dogs are extremely dangerous. They have the killer tendency. They're not real big. You know, they're smaller like this, but they're powerful dogs. He took him home into his house, and when he closed the door, the dog attacked him and killed him. Can you imagine that? The dog attacked him and killed him, and bit him so many times the man died. It's just happened like a day or two ago. So here he's talking about the prestige of so-called popularity. Popularity is pratista. Again, the same word that's coming up on almost every verse. In the material realm is compared to a treacherous dog-eating witch. Okay, it's even worse than the Rottweiler. It's a witch that eats dogs like the Rottweilers, right? And the attempt to... a person who seeks prestige, fame, recognition. I did this, I did that. If you ever hear Obama speak, they count the number of times he says I in his speech. In a normal speech, he'll say I maybe 40 times or 50 times. I did this, I did that. In fact, all the politicians are like that. If you elect me, I will do this and I will do that and I will give you this and I that, you see. So there's a saying in Turkish that says that a person who always says I is the devil, right? Because they're trying to build their name up or their fame up, or that's what he's talking about, building up pratista. And he says, the prestige of so-called popularity in the material realm is compared to a treacherous dog-eating witch. So a person who's always vaunting themselves, praising themselves, I did this, I did that, this, I built this, I did, they are overwhelmed with this desire to accumulate pratista, name and fame. And then he says, the relationship between a devotee and Lord Hari is devoid of even a trace of worldly illusion. What is the worldly illusion? Thinking I'm a great person. No, I'm the humble servant of the Lord. Gopi Bhartur Padakamalayur Dasa 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 Dasanu Dasa. That's Lord Chaitanya said, I'm not a Brahmin, I'm not a Kshatriya, I'm not a Vaishya, I'm not a Sudra, I'm not this, I'm not that. What am I? And this is the answer to the question, who am I? Right? That question was asked today on Sankirtan to one of the devotees. They said, can you tell me who am I? So, Lord Chaitanya answers it. Gopi Bhartur Padakamalaya Dasa Dasa Dasanu Dasa. I'm not a Brahmin, I'm not a Kshatriya, I'm not a Vaishya, I'm not a Sudra. I'm not a Brahmachari, I'm not a Grihastha, I'm not a Vanaprastha, I'm not a Sannyasi. I am the servant of the servant of the servant of the servant of the servant ad infinitum of the gopis who are serving Radha and Krishna. That's who I am. I'm the eternal servant of the servants of the Lord. So that means that the relationship between the devotee and Krishna is completely devoid of even a trace of worldly illusion. What's the worldly illusion? I am as rich as Bill Gates. I am the president of the country. I did this and I did that. You know, the I. There's a song in Mexico. I. So this is the I song. This is what the Mexicans are chanting all day long. Of course, their I is different than our I, right? But it's the same sound. It's a song where a person is tooting their horn all day long about how great they are. You know? And as far as Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur is concerned, that Sukhera Vista, it's no better than the stool of a pig. Then Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur says, I shall give up chanting the Lord's holy name publicly in kirtan and retire to solitude, thus smearing myself with worldly honor. So he's quoting what the pratistha seekers do. Dear mind, what is the good of seeking such so-called glory? I will always remind you that the great soul, Madhavendra Puri, never deceived himself in that regard of committing theft in his own storehouse of perception the way you do. So this is poetic language. He's talking about the stealing, becoming a thief in his own storehouse of perception. So we create different concepts in our mind, perceptions. And we steal from ourselves the opportunity to be Krishna conscious because we've developed those false concepts. And then we chase after what's called a phantasmagoria, a hava mahal. The word hava mahal is equal to phantasmagoria in English. Phantasmagoria means something fantastic that's actually an illusion, it doesn't exist. And hava mahal is something fantastic that's an illusion because it doesn't exist. There's no hava mahal, right? There's no palace in the sky. So we steal from ourselves the opportunity to be Krishna conscious by developing or accepting these false concepts in the mind and then following them, chasing after. If you've ever read the history, the novel by Cervantes, a Spanish author, the name of the novel is Don Quixote. I don't know if you ever heard of it before. Don Quixote was a nobleman who had a sidekick. I forget the sidekick's name. And the sidekick would ride on a donkey, and Don Quixote would ride on a big horse, and he had a long lance like this. He was a kshatriya, you know. And they would go out and fight imaginary demons. Every time he would see a windmill in the distance, he was like, oh, there's the enemy. And they charged towards the windmill, and when they got to the windmill, they saw it wasn't actually an enemy, it was a windmill. But in their mind, it was an enemy. You see, so that type of illusory chasing after things that are actually not there, they're misconceiving what they are, that's being compared here to cheating yourself. You're not cheating others now, you're cheating yourself by seeking worldly fame. See, even in the pre-medieval Christian history, you had monks that would spend their whole life making manuscripts of the Bible. There was no printing press at that time, so they had to copy the Bible by hand. And the Bible's long, right? They would not only copy the Bible, they would also paint every page. Beautiful designs, intricate, beautiful design. I don't know if you've ever seen biblical manuscripts. They're very expensive because they're all handmade books and they're all hand illustrated. And they're all handwritten. And it would take them years to develop the skill of writing, you know, in such nice calligraphy, and to become such great artists. And they never signed their name to it. They were anonymous. They wanted Jesus to have all the glory. They wouldn't even put their name to it. Same thing in India. You have tremendous sculptors that sculpted fabulous temples, spent generations making temples. Not one of their names are on that temple. It's not like today. You go all over India, you see Birla temple, right? It's not Krishna temple, it's Birla temple. Right? Everyone says Birla temple, right? Why should it be Birla Temple? The main deity is Krishna, right? Or Ram. Why is it Birla Temple? Because? Yes. Sukera Vista. Then, your cheap reputation is equal to the stool of a hog. So that's the second time he's saying it, right? In verse 2, now in verse 8. An ordinary ambitious man like you can never be equated with a devotee like Madhavendra Puri's eminence. Now, who is Madhavendra Puri? He is the link between the Madhava Sampradaya and Gaudiya Sampradaya. He was initiated in the Madhava Sampradaya, but he initiated Ishwara Puri, who initiated Lord Chaitanya. So that's the link. Therefore, we're called Brahma Madhava Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya. Begins Krishna to Brahma, and then coming down to Madhavacharya, and then going over to Lord Chaitanya and the Gaudiya tradition. Right. Okay, so he's saying that your cheap reputation is equal to the stool of a hog. An ordinary ambitious man like you can never be equated with a devotee of Madhavendra Puri's eminence. Now, who is Madhavendra Puri? He initiated, by the way, Advaitacharya and Lord Nityananda. They were disciples of Madhavendra Puri, if I'm not mistaken, Nityananda also. And Lord Chaitanya was very pleased by Madhavendra Puri. He was the one that discovered the Gopala Diti in Govardhan. He had a dream one night. He saw that this deity was crying and saying, please come and bathe me with cooling waters and sandalwood paste. I'm scorching under this hot sun. And he woke up and he was like shocked. And the next day he looked around and he found the deity, the Gopala deity. And then he established it on top of Govardhan and established the worship of the deity. And then one day the deity spoke to him and said, look, this is not enough. Go to Orissa and bring me back some pure sandalwood paste. So Orissa is like, I don't know, 2,000 miles away, right? And there were no railroads at that time. He had to walk. And it was also dangerous. You had to pass through sometimes the entire Jharkhand forest to get there. And through different Muslim kingdoms. Each kingdom you had to pay a tax if you went on the road. And if you went in the back ways, it was always more dangerous, right? Anyway, on the way, he stops in Remuna. And he sees Gopinath deity. And he hears about the special kheer that they offer the Gopinath, the special rice pudding, payasam. And he's saying, oh, if I could only taste that, then I could make the same thing for my Gopal. And then he said, oh my God, what have I done? They're just making the offering now and I'm trying to taste it. You know, he felt very ashamed. He said, I'm just going to fast. So he leaves the temple and goes somewhere and he's just chanting Hare Krishna. He's not going to go to sleep. He's just going to fast. But that night, Gopinath steals one pot of rice from the offering and hides it underneath his dress. And then pujaris close the temple and they go and take rest. And during the night, the head pujari has a dream and Gopinath is saying, come to me. I've stolen a pot of rice. I want you to find Madhavendra Puri and give it to him. So the pujari wakes up and he says, was it a dream or was the deity talking to me? He's not sure. So he goes to the temple late at night, opens it up, goes in, and when he puts his hand underneath the deity, underneath the dress, there's a pot of rice. And he's shocked, you know. And he thanks the deity. And then he goes out into the village and he's calling out in the middle of the night, is Madhavendra Puri here? Is he here? Gopinath has sent me with a pot of rice for you. And he finds Madhavendra Puri because he didn't go to sleep. He was fasting all night and chanting Hare Krishna. And he tells him and he gives him the pot of rice. And Madhavendra Puri is like, you know, shocked. And he's thinking, oh my God, you know, the Lord has become a thief. So then they renamed that deity Shira Chora Gopinath. That deity is still there. You can see it in Ramuna. And the next day comes, Madhavendra Puri is thinking, if I stay here, like a lot of people are going to come. They're going to hear about this. And it's going to be very embarrassing for him. So he leaves right away. He doesn't want, you know, throngs of people around him and asking him for asirvad, you know. And because he's not attached to pratistha, name and fame. And he very slowly ate all the sweet rice. And then he broke the pot and powdered it and ate the pot also. Because it was all given to him as prasadam from the deity, you see. And these are real devotees, you know. They're not, you know, they're not 21st century devotees. They're hardcore. So he's saying here, you can never be equated with a devotee of Madhavendra Puri's eminence. So you can't imitate Madhavendra Puri or even come close to his devotion, you know. And then he says, under the sway of envy, you have drowned yourself in the filthy waters of material enjoyment after having abandoned the excellent perfection of congregational kirtan. So this is basically what happened to that Brahmana disciple of Gaurakishore Babaji. By disregarding the order of a spiritual master and accepting the opulent food that was brought as donation, Gaurakishore Babaji told him, don't accept those donations of opulent food, just give them away to people. He disregarded his guru's instruction and ate that food, and then later he became addicted to sense gratification. And then he insulted Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, and basically he fell down after that. He was sent away by Gaurakishore Babaji. Then he says, truly, a wicked mind, the glories of so-called solitary worship are propagated only by false yogis using unscrupulous means to deceive others. To save yourself from these pitfalls, please contemplate the instructions that the Supreme Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu kindly gave us while addressing Srila Sanatana Goswami with the utmost care. So, like in India, there's one so-called famous man called Meher Baba. Have you ever heard of Meher Baba? His claim to fame is that he did Monavrata for 40 years. You see. Now, what is Monavrata? It means you don't talk. All right? It just remains silent. And he became famous for his 40 years of Monavrata. He became very famous. But Monavrata is suggested for people who talk too much nonsense. In other words, people who have a big mouth, as we say in English. So Monavrata is recommended for them because the more they talk, the more nonsense they speak. So it's better they don't say anything. So it's not that, you know, it's a badge of honor to have done Monavrata for 40 years. It just means that you were talking so much nonsense that you were told to keep your mouth, big mouth shut, you know. But did Jesus Christ remain silent? When he gave the sermon on the mount, he didn't say, now let us all do silent meditation. No, he gave the sermon on the mount. There's a time for peace and a time for this and a time. It's the most famous preaching sermon that he ever gave. He wasn't silent. He didn't do Monavrata. When you speak significant words of praise of God and spiritual instructions, then you don't have to keep Monavrata. But if you speak nonsense, then it's better to do Monavrata. See? So here he's saying this solitary worship, this doing these austerities, like for example in India, there's one sadhu is known as the rolling sadhu. So he rolled on the ground from Delhi to Katra, right? So he became famous. You know, there were newspapers taking pictures of him rolling on the highway. You know. So because he did that, he became famous. Then there was another Baba. His name was Airplane Baba. Because he used to be an airline pilot. So then when he turned Baba, they call him Airplane Baba. You know. So you see, people become famous for doing so-called, you know, some kinds of austerity, like rolling on the ground, or like there was one Baba. He, whenever he would speak, he would cry, and the tears would like fly out of his eyes. So this one boy was trying to figure out, you know, that such a saintly man. So he hid himself in the Baba's room behind the curtain. He wanted to see, you know, if the Baba would cry even when he was alone. So he was there watching through the curtain, and the Baba came into his private room after doing his show, you know, of crying and tears flying out all over the place. And then when the Baba came in, he sat down and he went like this. And he pulled a very long red chili out of his nose. Then the boy realized the whole thing was a trick. He would insert this chili, very hot, what do you call it? Chili into his nose, and it would cause his eyes to tear violently, you know. And everyone thought, oh, Baba is in samadhi, you know, full of tears of love. But actually, it was just a trick. So people like tricks. They like magicians, you know, because magicians do sleight of hand, and they do tricks. They're called magician. Another word for a magician is illusionist. They create an illusion, see? And people, you know, they like it. However, there was, Prabhupada tells of this one man, Mr. Chakravarti. He was a very famous illusionist in Calcutta. When Prabhupada was a young boy, he went to a show where Mr. Chakravarti was performing. And during this show, they tied him up in iron chains with locks on it. And they put him in a box, and they locked the box. And they showed everyone. You know, everyone could come and see the box and touch it and see the lock. And it was real. And they were able to see the chains also, right? And the locks on the chains. And then they closed the curtain and they said, Mr. Chakravarti, can you play the harmonium? And all of a sudden they hear this harmonium playing. You know? And then they open the curtain and there's Chakravarti smiling, playing the harmonium, right? On top of the box. Then they close the curtain and they open it again very quickly and he's not there. Then they open a box, they undo the lock on a big block on the box, they open it up and Chakravarti comes out and he's got all these chains on him and he's all locked up in him and they untie him. And Prabhupada was like amazed. And he says, Chakravarti was a real yogi. Now, in America they had someone like him. His name was Houdini. Houdini was one of the most famous magicians in America, if not the most famous. And he would also do a trick. They would tie him up in chains with locks on it, and they'd throw him into a river, right in the middle of a river, right? And he would get out of it and swim back. And they couldn't figure out how he did it, because any ordinary man, you know, first of all, the chains are heavy, right? And secondly, they're locked. There's different locks on it. You can't even move your arms, right? And he would get out of it, and he'd swim back. And then later on, he revealed how he would do it. He would twist his body. He was a yogi, so he would twist his body in such a way that he could get out of the chain, even though it was locked, you know. So, but Prabhupada said that Mr. Chakravarti was a mystic yogi. There was no trick. He was actually somehow or other in some mystical way, because yogis, there's nine yogic perfections. One of them is mahima, and then lagima. Lagima, if I'm not mistaken, means you become as small as an atom, and you can go through a wall, or you can get out of a lockbox, whatever. So, and there's mahima, you can become big, very big, just like Vamana Dev, he his leg became so big it touched the end of the universe, right? So maybe yogis are not that powerful, but they can become very big, they become very small, they can walk on water, become lighter than a feather, and so forth. So here it says, truly, O wicked mind, the glories of so-called solitary worship are propagated only by false yogis, using unscrupulous means to deceive others. To save yourself from these pitfalls, please contemplate the instructions that the Supreme Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu kindly gave us while addressing Srila Sanatana Goswami with the utmost care. Well, what did Lord Chaitanya tell Sanatana Goswami? He explained to him what is pure devotional service. And explained to him, get rid of all worldly trappings of opulence. So when Sanatana Goswami met Lord Chaitanya, he was very wealthy, as was his brother. They gave away all their wealth. But someone had given Sanatana Goswami a very expensive chadar. So when he met Lord Chaitanya, he had this expensive chadar on. And although Chaitanya Mahaprabhu hugged him, internally he wasn't pleased that he had such an opulent chadar. So somehow Sanatana Goswami understood that. So he went away to take a bath, and on the bank of the Ganges he met a very poor brahmana. And he asked him if he could accept his opulent chadar, and the brahmana would exchange it for his. Now the brahmana's chadar was tattered, it had holes in it, it was old, and it was faded color, it wasn't white. You know how if you don't have bleach and you don't have washing machines, you know, you keep washing something, it becomes dark in color. And they exchanged, and he got rid of his expensive chadar. And then when he came back to see Lord Chaitanya, he had this old tattered chadar, and Lord Chaitanya was very pleased because he gave up his attachment to opulent food, opulent clothing, opulent jewelry, all signs of opulence. Because a sannyasi is naturally has a vow of renunciation, a vow of poverty, right? Even if he really receives tremendous wealth, he doesn't use it to improve his level of material comfort. He uses it only for spreading Krishna consciousness. So if you go to Mayapur today, you'll see Prabhupada's room, a very simple little room where he stayed in Mayapur. It's a very, very simple room. He always lived very simply. And you'll see the plates he had. There were stone plates that he used for getting his prasadam. And the only opulence he had was he had a beautiful deity of Lord Chaitanya that he worshipped, you know. So, do not forget for a moment the two most valuable concepts that Lord Chaitanya taught Sanatana Goswami. One, the principle of dry, apparent renunciation as opposed to real, appropriate renunciation. And two, the principle of a soul being trapped in the bondage of matter as opposed to a soul who is liberated. Don't ever make the mistake of thinking that these conflicting concepts are on the same level. Please remember this while engaging yourself in chanting the Lord's holy names as loud as you possibly can. So, this dry, apparent renunciation as opposed to real, appropriate renunciation. So, real, appropriate renunciation is regulated devotional service. Regulated devotion. And dry, apparent renunciation is made up austerities just to gather attention. Like someone will say, well, I'm going a complete fast for 1 week. Prabhupada didn't ask us to go on a fast for 1 week. He asked us to fast on festival days and Ekadasi. If you just follow what Prabhupada said, you'll be very healthy. He said, don't eat opulent food, just eat simple food. Maybe once a week you eat a little bit of opulent food in a Sunday feast, but the rest of the time just eat very simple food. And have simple cloth. Don't try and have big fancy cloth. And live a simple life. Simple living, high thinking. Not high living, no thinking. So, therefore, and the principle of a soul being trapped in the bondage of matter, as opposed to a soul who's liberated. So a soul is liberated. Iha yasya harir dasya kamana manasajira akilasvapi vasta su jivan mukta sa uchyate. Even in this body, even in the material world, you can be a liberated soul if you use your intelligence, your mind, your physical strength, physical activity, and your money. Use everything in the service of Krishna. Then you're a liberated soul. If your purpose is to please Krishna rather than please yourself, then you become a liberated soul. Or as it said in Bhagavad Gita, we read this the last time we had our class. Karma yukta phalam tyakva. Let's see, one second. Chakva karma phalasangam nitya chipja nirashraya karmani apipavritopi naiva kinchit karotisa. So it says, abandoning all attachment to the results of his activities, ever satisfied and independent, the devotee performs no fruitive action, although engaged in all kinds of undertakings. So when one is chakva karma phalasangam, abandoning all attachment to the results of activities. How do you abandon all attachment to the results of activities? You don't give up activities. You offer the result of the activity to Krishna. Right. And then, nitya tripta nirashraya. So nitya tripta means always satisfied, regardless of what condition one is in. You can tell who is affected by Maya because they're always complaining about something. That means Maya's got a grip on their mind. They're always, this is not good, that's not good, this person is like this, that person is like that. The people who are like that, they are Maya's number one follower. Doesn't matter, they're dressed like a devotee or whatever. They are in Maya's grip. This is not good, that's not good, this person said this, that person didn't do this, you know. Never, they're not nitya tripta nirashraya. Nirashraya means they're not even attached to have a fixed place of residence. Karmani apipavrito pi, although they're fully engaged in all kinds of activities, naiva kinchit karoti sa, they're fully independent and satisfied, no matter what condition they're in. Because they're abandoning all the result of their activity to Krishna. They're not attached to the result. They're happy to see Krishna satisfied. That's their satisfaction. Krishna and Krishna's devotees, and above all, Krishna's pure devotee, Srila Prabhupada. Yukta karma phalam tyakva santim apnoti naistikim ayukta kamakarena phale sakto nibadyate. The steadily devoted soul attains unadulterated peace because he offers the results of all activities to me, Krishna says. Whereas a person who is not in union with the divine, who is greedy for the fruits of his labor, becomes entangled. So, if we're greedy for the fruits of the labor, if we want recognition, the pratista, the sukhera vista, the stool of a pig, then we become entangled by our own selfishness in search of fame, recognition. I did this, I did that. Or aham mameti, the syndrome of I, me, and mine. So it's not only I, there's the me also. There's the me mantra also, and the mine mantra. See? There's the I, and there's the me, and there's mine. Now you see this in little kids. They're only like 1 or 2 or 3 years old. They're getting into fights with other kids. This is mine. No, don't take it. This is mine. You see, they're fighting with you. Now, where did they learn that? No one taught them this is mine, did they? Where did they learn that? It's ingrained by karmic reactions from previous lives. So unless Kumaran Acharet Pragno, unless one begins from early childhood to be trained in Krishna consciousness, this I, me, and mine, this aham mameti, just becomes stronger and stronger because it's already there from previous lives. It must be rooted out. So the difference between a person in Krishna consciousness and a person in bodily consciousness is that the former, the person in Krishna consciousness, is attached to Krishna, whereas the latter is attached to the fruits of his activities. Right? The person who is attached to Krishna and works for him only is certainly a liberated person. And he has no anxiety over the results of his work. In the Bhagavatam, the cause of anxiety over the result of an activity is explained as being one's functioning in the conception of duality. That is, without knowledge of the absolute truth. So in other words, if we don't accept that Krishna, Bahunam janmanamante gyanamam prapadyante vasudeva sarvamiti samhatma sudurlabha. If one does not accept Vasudeva Sarvamiti, Krishna, you are everything for me, then they are in material consciousness. Because, and they will be troubled by duality. Should I do this? Should I do that? Ah, it's too cold today. Ah, it's too hot today. This prasadam is not as good as it was yesterday. This thing, that, there's dualities everywhere. I don't like this person, I like this person. See? I love you, I hate you. These are all dualities, and people are confused by it because they're functioning in conception of duality. Why? Because they haven't fixed their mind on Vasudeva Sarvamiti. Krishna, you are everything for me. I don't need anything else. No. Yeah, I want Krishna, but I also want BMW. Yeah, I like Krishna, but I also want to have a second wife. I like Krishna, but I'm not satisfied with my apartment. You know, I want to get a big house because this other idiot bought a big house, so I want a big house. Yeah. You see, they're not nitya tripta. They're not always satisfied. They're always dissatisfied. No matter what, they're still dissatisfied. See? And they're always functioning within duality because they haven't fixed their mind on Vasudeva Sarvamiti. Krishna is everything for me. I don't need anything else. You see? When Prahlad Maharaj was offered any benediction, he said, no, my Lord, just let me always remain your devotee. Even in the Dhammadharastikam, the prayer, Vanam Deva Moksham Na Moksham Va Lachanyam Rineham Varesada Piha Idam Te Vapur Nata Gopala Balam Sadame Mana Savirastam Kimanyai. This is a very important verse, right? It says, O Lord, although you are able to give all kinds of benedictions, I do not pray to you for the benediction of impersonal liberation, nor the highest liberation of eternal life in Vaikuntha. So I don't even want Vaikuntha. Nor any other benediction which may be obtained by executing the 9 processes of bhakti. Just by engaging in bhakti, you're showered with benedictions. Right? He said, I don't want any of them. I don't want Salokya, Sarupya, Samyuktya, Sarstri, Sayuga. I don't want any of those. O Lord, I simply wish that this form of yours as Bala Gopal in Vrindavan may ever be manifest in my heart. For what is the use to me of any other benediction besides this? So he only wants to fix this image of Mother Yasoda tying up Bala Gopal Krishna to the mortar. He wants that fixed in his mind eternally. And that's enough for him. He doesn't want anything else. Because if you fix Krishna in your mind, then you're permanently Krishna conscious. Because we live in the mind. We don't live in this world. We live in the mind. See? We're perceiving things differently. Just like the thief perceives your child, or the child molester perceives your child as an object of pleasure for him. But the parent perceives the child as an object of love and does everything to protect the child. So two people looking at the same thing. Two people read the Bible at night. One saw black and one saw white. You see? So everyone sees differently based on how they're influenced by the modes of material nature, even though they're looking at the same thing. Okay. Therefore, matravat paradarisu, lustravat paradravyesu, atmavat sarvabhutesu, napasyati sapandita. The pundit sees every other woman except his wife as his mother. And the women pundits see every other man except her husband as her father. And the pundit sees other people's wealth like pebbles in the street, valueless for him. And he treats others as he would treat himself. Right? That's called, and the Christians call that the golden rule. Do unto others as you will have them do unto you. But Chanakya Pandit gave this rule also. Atmavat sarvabhutesu. Treat all others as you would treat yourself. Okay, so therefore, the cause of anxiety over the result of an activity is explained as being once functioning in the conception of duality, that is, without knowledge of the absolute truth. Krishna is the supreme absolute truth, the personality of Godhead. In Krishna consciousness, there's no duality. Why? Because Vasudeva Sarvamiti. Our only purpose is to please Krishna. We don't have to think, should I please Krishna? Okay, I'll please him 50% of the time. The other 50% of the time, I'll do whatever nonsense I want. No. One is going to dedicate 100% to pleasing Krishna. Therefore, there's no duality. Should I go to India? Should I stay here? Should I buy this stock? Should I buy that stock? This thing, that thing. You know, people get confused by this. You just fix your mind on one thing, pleasing Krishna. All other goals will be achieved. As it says in the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Yavan Artha Udapane. It says, Yavan Artha Udapane, Sarvata Sampluto Dake, Tavan Sarve Suvede Su Brahmanasya Vijanataha. All purposes served by a small pond, a small well, can at once be served by a great reservoir of water. Similarly, all the purposes of the Vedas can be served to one who knows the purpose behind the Vedas. So what is the purpose behind the Vedas? Exactly right. Vedesu. Yeah. Sarvasya chayam hridi sannivisto matak smriti jnanam apanam cha vedesu sarva. What is it? Vedesu. Yeah. Aham eva vedya vinanta krit vedavit eva chayam. So the purpose behind the Vedas is to know Krishna, to serve Krishna. Vedesu aham eva vedya, right? So, if you know the purpose behind the Vedas, then all other purposes are served. So in other words, if you just please Krishna, everything else will be taken care of by Krishna's mercy. We have to have that faith. All that exists, in Krishna consciousness, there's no duality. All that exists is a product of Krishna's energy. And Krishna is all good. Therefore, activities in Krishna consciousness are on the absolute plane. They are transcendental and have no material effect. One is therefore filled with peace in Krishna consciousness. But one who is entangled in profit calculation for sense gratification cannot have that peace. This is the secret of Krishna consciousness. Realization that there is no existence besides Krishna is the platform of peace and fearfulness. Vasudeva Sarvamiti. There's no existence besides Krishna. It's the platform of peace and fearlessness, right? Of Shanti and Abhaya. Okay, so this is Bhakti Sanat Saraswati Thakura's beautiful, and these are only a few of the verses. It's much longer than 10 verses. It goes on, I think, 30 or 40 verses. Dustamana. And he was a disciple of Gaurakishore Babaji. So he is encapsulating in this transcendental bhajan the teaching that he imbibed from Gaurakishore Babaji. Sometimes you can know the guru better through the disciple. When you meet a true disciple, then you can know who the guru is. Yata yoni yata bij. As the womb, so the child, you know. Okay, so are there any questions or comments? Today is Gaurakishore Babaji's disappearance day, so I tried to say a few words. Okay, Sanskriti, ask a question. Yeah. Have any questions? No? Okay.
I just want to confirm whether I have heard correctly or not. You were saying one of the disciples of Gaurakishore Babaji, accepting opulence, government was. But not to put it up, that Gaurakishore Babaji is Babaji's only disciple in Bhaktisiddhanta Sastrinagar, so he has not accepted any other disciples.
Well, he had this person became a servant. Maybe, I don't know if he formally initiated him or not, but he was serving him intimately for some time, for some years. And then later on, he sent him away. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay, so we'll stop there and continue tomorrow, 5:30 in the morning. Adi Bol. Jai. Huh? Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we will have. We didn't do RT either. Okay. Shri Guru Charana Padma Kevala Bhakati Satma
Charane rati eseyutamagati ye prasade pure sarva asa. Shakshudan dilaje janme janme prabhu se. Shakshudan dilaje janme janme prabhu se. Divya gyani de prakashito. Shri Guru Karuna. Prema bhakti jaha hoite avidya vinasa jade. Prema bhakti jaha hoite avidya vinasa jade. Vede gajana racharito. Vede gajana racharito. Shri Guru Karuna Sindhu Adana Janara Bandhu. Shri Guru Karuna Sindhu Adana Janara Bandhu. Lokena Lokera Jivana. Lokena Lokera Jivana. Haha Prabhu Kura Doya Deha More Pada Choya. Aha Prabhu Kura Doya Deha More Pada Choya. Ebe Asku Sukti Bhuvana. Ebe Asku Sukti Bhuvana. Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada.